So I wanted to start by asking about something that you've talked about before, but hopefully won't mind talking about again, and that's the book cover. Can someone hold it up? Someone near the front? People probably have seen it.
Somebody have the book? Yeah, yeah.
It's 20-odd colored stripes across the book. People know it. They know it. People know it. But you might want to be reminded. So I wanted to ask you about that because you were, to some degree, involved. At least you encouraged a direction for that cover. Could you talk a little bit about what you wanted to avoid and how this may have achieved that avoidance?
Yeah, I had written an essay in the New York Times Book Review, I guess it's almost 2 years ago now, called The Second Shelf. And one of the things, it was about the different treatment of women and men in literary fiction. And one of the things that I had noticed, I'd done a very unscientific study of looking at covers, book covers, and there were a lot of book covers of, you know, girls in a field of wheat, or one that I discovered later, which is Women in Water. And I think they gave the covers what a sort of a kind of dreamy inessentiality. And the idea of sort of imagining, you know, men walking around, hey, Bill, what's that you're reading? Oh, Little Girl in a Field of Wheat, I love that. You know, I didn't see it. Which isn't to say that books should be like that unisex bathroom boring figure, you know. They should be inviting. They should make you want to read it. They should not exclude anyone, you know, ideally. And I think that this cover, you know, it's gender neutral, but it's bright and inviting, and it's a big typeface. I was so embarrassed when I saw how big my name was. I don't know what that is. It's like I said to them, can you make it smaller? Can you hide the book? Can you, you know?
How many bands? Your name stretches across four bands? More than four
More
bands?
More than four bands?
I think it's in your contract, right? Four bands?
It is now, yes.
So, and in one of the interviews about it, you said you wanted it to be, I think the metaphor was like a box of chocolates or something in one of them. And I thought that was an interesting, because there's such a resistance, it's playing off what you just said, there's a resistance to thinking of books as products in a sense, but they are, they're thought products. And you want somebody to come to them and come into them in the same terms that they would anything else. And without, what I thought was great about the essay, which we'll talk a little bit about later, but only a little bit, is that you point out that traditionally, too much is loaded into those other images. As you say, there's when you come to the book, you already have a kind of reading map for it, if it's a traditional
one. Yeah, you might think, you might think wrongly, oh, this is a kind of book that I don't want to read, or that I do want to read, and you're wrong. You know, it's like, I like something elliptical that gives, like what I loved about this cover, like as soon as I saw this cover, I loved it. I mean, there was never an issue with it. Because it just seemed to sort of bring up a sort of feeling of the 70s, and you know, the book opens the summer that Nixon resigned, and it just sort of had a kind of batik tie-dye. Batik, there's a word I haven't used in a very long time. And tie-dye.
It's not batik though, is it? The art?
No, it's not. No, it's amazing how use we have really for the word batik and macrame, just parenthetically, and decoupage, that's another one. These are like, it's bringing up so much, discussing this
just
with you tonight.
Batik?
Just the word batik, I'm like, I'm really kind of having
Yeah, my mom had a batik company briefly in the 70s.
Did she?
Yeah, I'm not lying. Why would I lie about a thing like that? It's totally true. You read, as you say, a scene that takes place in the 70s, but the book actually spans a much broader time than that. And this is something, I don't know if you can say or if authors like it when other people say, oh, this is one of your themes, but I'm going to go ahead and say it, and you can make the face that you do when people say those things. But it's not just in this book, it's many books where characters return over a long time, many books of yours, return over a long time span to see if their ideas of themselves have shifted or been forced to shift. In, again, a book like The Position, it's done through the prism of this sex manual. In this book, it's done with, you know, you pull characters through time. So at the risk of attaching a theme to you, why are you so interested in long-term change?
How could I not be? I mean, right? Aren't you seeing it before your eyes? It's like life is this terrifying, like, experiment. Like, my kids used to do experiments. We'd come in every day and see how something got more rotten, you know, under under a glass. That's, like, my life, right? I mean, but I am interested in that as a theme because it just becomes, you know, as you get older and friends die or you see people physically change. I mean, the internet, the weird thing about that, among many things, was that you know, you could see what happened to people from your past and how they looked physically. I mean, I was very, very affected by the Michael Apted films, the 7-Up, 28 Up films, which was a real influence for me writing this book. I mean, he, for those of you who don't know it, he's a British documentarian, and he filmed a group of British school children every 7 years, and the most recent one is 56 Up. I mean, on the internet, you can go look at people, basically stalk them online. I've heard tell, you can do that. But I just love seeing how things change, but how they're there. Like, the nucleus of the person is still there in the one you knew. But I mean, for me, this is like, yes, summer camp was a great way of doing that. How many people in this room went to summer camp? Oh, that's a lot, like a New York audience. Like, sometimes. But for those of you who didn't, I mean, this isn't a summer camp novel. It, as Ben said, it follows over a long period of time as the characters enter the sadness of middle age and their lives get disappointed. So how many of you have entered middle age and your lives feel disappointing? Oh, that's great. Now everybody can relate. Oh, that's wonderful.
You do that a show of hands for people who are disappointed.
Disappointed.
The Michael Apted series, there's a point in that series that also happens in this book where hope, it's not that it disappears, but it changes and disappointments creep in. So did you, I guess, related to that, when you started with the book, when it was the first glimmer, did you start with characters or plot, or do they always start parallel? I mean, in other words, well, just answer that, and then I'll have a follow-up. Yeah.
So demanding. Answer that.
Answer that, please, and then I'll have a follow-up.
You know, it's weird, the books that you mentioned,
the books.
That is the period of time, and I've talked about this with my editor, Sarah, when I feel that I sort of came to write the things that I wanted to write more, and it started with a book called The Wife. It was as if, like, prior to that, none of my books had the in the title. It's almost as though I'm saying, no, this is the only book about a wife that you could ever read. The Wife, there's no other. But you have to believe that when you're writing a book. You know, it has to become the whole of the world. And there are so many ways into a novel. Novels are like advent calendars. There are a lot of doors that you can open to go in. For me personally, starting with the books, there's an idea. I don't like writing without an idea, because so I know where it's going, so that it doesn't just feel like it's a meditation on Sue and Jim's bad marriage. You know, I like the idea, but as soon as I get the idea, I really need the characters. Somebody said that what you remember of the novels you love is not plot, but character, and I think that's really, really true. The characters need to just sort of carry on looking at those themes. They need to be your emissaries for those themes.
I want to detour into another question briefly. How do you write literally? Like, what is the process? Has it changed over time? Is it the same as it was in 82? I assume it's different, but what's the daily process involved?
Boy, is it not the same as 82. Okay, so I wrote my first novel, Sleepwalking, which they've just reprinted, in college. And I wrote on a Smith Corona typewriter that was as loud as a blender. I'm like making margaritas, you know, and I used whiteout and a little brush. It's like, I mean, can you believe we all wrote novels that way? It's like doing scrimshaw.
So you were like, you know, a 19th century author.
I was a 19th century author. I used to wear a big bonnet and a very high collar, and I just sat very primly. And when a man came in, I would scurry out. You know, I
had heard that.
You've heard that about me, yes. But the thing is, you did it. You know, now it's like you write a book and you make so many changes, you don't even know what you've lost, which is really, you can't really see the whole trajectory, although it might be kind of nightmarish if you did. Although if you really want to know who you are as a person, not even just as a writer, there's one great way. I mean, Freud's notions of free association are sort of fake, because if you're doing it in front of another person, you're probably tailoring it. If you want to know who you are and what you're made of, just look at everything you've Googled for the past day. It's horrible. For me, it would be basically half Rilke and half does this mole look suspicious? You know, I mean, so to answer your question, I would write on a typewriter and I would write the whole thing. And I now have a kind of way that I write a book, my sort of 80-page way. And I feel like, it sounds so gimmicky, I feel like I'm advertising a Ginsu knife, but I really like to write 80 pages without worrying about anything. Because writers worry. or is it just me? Writers worry a lot. What will people think? What, you know, how will this be received? Is it too personal? Is all of the questions that start bothering you creep in, and they shouldn't be there in that moment of kind of the grandiosity that you need to write in the beginning, a kind of unfettered state. If you can write 80 pages and not worry, and then you print them out, and then you take them, if you live in New York, to a coffee shop, you pass them out among the patrons and say, what should I, you know? and you just go through it, like with a pen, and you take out the terrible stuff. And then you have to reckon with not what you wanted to do, but what you actually have done, what you have wrought, what you've written. And I think then, at that point, I start sort of structuring it more. And I write during, when my children were young. Having children is a great way to write books, because it does allow you really to know when your time should be spent working. You know, nap time is work time. And I like to keep banker's hours, because the later in the day, the blood sugar drops and your prose, you know, gets much more existential. I write all the time. I mean, when I was writing this book in particular was just a very happy writing experience for me. I just liked being in the presence of the characters. Like Ethan Figman, if any of you read the book, like I practically have a blow-up doll of him at home. I mean, I just loved him. I just loved him, and I liked thinking about them, and I liked just working out the problems with it. So I think the writing day would be, I'd go out on the subway, I'd send like what I'd been working on to myself on my little iPhone, and then it makes it look like it's a printed page, so you can see how it will look in a book. This is pathetic. Another trick that writers do all the time if something's going badly is just change the font. Then you send it into your editor, and she's like, this is brilliant. And I'm like, I didn't change a word. You were. No, not true.
Technology in that way, sending things to yourself, being able to write, note-taking has become immensely easier, obviously, over the last, you know, 5-6 years. And Alison Bechdel was here for 2 weeks ago for this exact same event. And she said, of course, she's a graphic novelist, but she said she uses a lot of photographs and Instagram and takes pictures of things, or will take pictures of herself in certain poses, her father's pose, and then draw herself in as that character. Mm. And I wondered, your physical descriptions of people are so, first of all, they're not idealized at all. There's a kind of beauty in the trivial ugliness of people. So half of the question is about that, how you look at people and how that unsparing eye developed to be okay with looking at people that way, or if you just do it naturally. And then the second thing is, with people, is there a tool for making them that vivid? Do you work off of photographs? Do you take pictures of strangers? Is it all from memory of people that you know that you're cobbling together?
I think that in terms of writing what feels true about people, my feeling as starting with the books really was that if you're not going to sort of try to be true, tell the truth, I mean, we in this room who love fiction, all of you, you know, feel that fiction contains the truth. We want to wear the sandwich board for fiction. We know that we live in a very nonfiction world propelled by anxiety, and people want to learn about what's true, but we think and we know that fiction contains what's true. So when you write about people, if you're going to try to gloss it over in some way, why, you know, why? It's kind of, I feel now like, along with my view of things changing and decaying quickly, if not now, when, you know? So you have to kind of write about people honestly. But to that point, I will say I don't write about people I know. I start to picture a person, but they're all sort of blurry faced in some way, like extras on a reality show don't want to be associated with the Real Housewives. They're blurry, but I know them, you know?
So you then fill in. In the passage that you read, or right after the passage that you read, there's a part about realism where they're talking about, the girls are talking about pineapple lifesavers and flavoring. And there's a kind of metaphor, or I don't know if you think of this as a metaphor, but in the book you say, when an artificial flavor is developed and is popularized to such a great degree, we start to see it as the real flavor. And we sort of lose sight of the real thing or what the real thing might taste like. If you ask somebody what's pineapple, most people will describe it as that artificial pineapple, because that's become more, that's dominated more. You mentioned reality TV just now. That's the most obvious and egregious case. But is that part of the program as well, like to bring the real, the unsentimental real back, both in people, I mean, this book, all of the books really have a great deal of sort of non-idealized, it's not sex, it's not explicit sex, but sexuality, all these things. Are there zones that you feel you find yourself shying away from that you have to go back and recapture because you want them there to create the whole picture?
You know, yeah, absolutely, because you want to create reality, but for me it's important that there has to be an effect. It's the effect is not just to create reality, but to take reality and have it somehow be concentrated in that bouillon cube idea of reality so that it has a real, for me, an emotional effect. I just really kind of want to write not just what I see, because a book doesn't take place on any day. It takes place on one day, which is like a heightened version of any other day. I was on a panel once with a couple of writers at a book festival, a couple of famous writers and one whose first book had come out, and she said to us, to the other writers on the panel afterwards, how do you write the things you write? And I think it was sexuality was really part of it. She said, I could never face the mothers at my kids' school. And I felt bad for her, but I love, you know, writing fiction because I have this maybe demented idea that fiction gives me this like freedom from being seen in any way, like Wonder Woman's bracelets. I write fiction, that's not possibly true. You know, the woman has never done any of those things. You know, but I think it's true. I don't think that those questions are relevant. And you have to, even if other people think that, you can't control other people, though God knows I try. You can't control other people, so you have to write the thing you want to write. If you don't write the book you want to find on the shelf, you will inevitably be pleasing only some people who you may not even like and not writing the book you wanted to write.
I want to glancingly return to what you opened up with, which was the New York Times essay, Second Shelf. And so obviously the argument there that you made is that women's books of a certain type are classed as women's fiction or women's literature rather than books of a certain type that just happen to be written by women, and that there's a whole set of expectations and prejudices that come along with that. My question's a little different. I wanted to ask you if at some point after writing that, it got a lot of attention, many of the interviews for many months opened with questions about the essay. Did it shift for you? Did you feel at some point like you were becoming a kind of spokesperson for a cause, or did you think that it just played itself out in some way?
Look, I think it's an important issue. You can get repetitive. I feel like I said it best in that essay, and everything that I've said since then is sort of diminishing returns. But it still remains an important issue for writers, because if you look at VITA, the wonderful organization, their numbers, you know, still there's a real imbalance in literary publications about the number of men writing and reviewing books and being reviewed versus women. So I think it's still worth saying, but mostly I'm a fiction writer.
And you're also a second-generation example of this, or maybe an example of how people can break this, that in the sense that your mother was a novelist as well.
Is still
a novelist, right?
Yes. But,
as a child, growing up and watching your mother write and watching that, we talked about this a little bit before. What was different then for women writers?
Oh, it was really a different time. I think about it a lot. One way that was sort of more progressive in a funny way, we were talking about this at the table a little bit, back, if some of you remember, do you remember when women's magazines ran fiction? Like you could have on one page of a women's magazine, you could have a recipe for that casserole with the green beans and the jerky onion rings, and on the other facing page, you'd have a short story by Joyce Carol Oates. I mean, that is gone from that world, from our world. But women's magazines ran quality fiction, so there were more outlets for writers to publish women, and they weren't seen as women's fiction. They were just sort of taken more seriously. But my mother is a real autodidact. She didn't go to college. Her parents didn't think it was important, and she read a lot. She and my father read a lot of fiction, and she was very affected by the women's movement and really sort of given the sort of courage to write just sort of from what interested her. On a side note, I too was affected by the women's movement, and I started a consciousness raising group in my junior high school, and we wrote away to the National Organization for Women asking for a list of suggested topics, and they sent us a list like orgasm and you, when what we wanted we wanted was like when your parents won't listen, you know. But it was a much more boldly stratified fiction world, I think, back then. There were, you know, that's the it was the world of, you know, Updike, and it was that era of those writers. And I would sort of look in my parents' den, and a lot of the writers that they read were men. Also, though, interestingly, and something that I did mention in that essay, too, which is that one of the nice byproducts of the women's movement was that we got a chance to see novels by women, you know, from quarters that we might not have heard from otherwise. Suddenly, these voices became sort of interesting to hear from, and you'd get Louise Erdrich and Toni Morrison came about. So I think that there's a relationship between the women's movement and those writers coming to prominence.
One of the things that I like about all of the books, and when I go back to them, this is one of the things I notice, is that the characters are never in bubbles. And what I mean by that, at least in part, is that success and failure seem to weigh heavily on your characters, or the notions of it, or at least over the course of a life, because you're looking at over a wide time span, the goals that they set for themselves and whether these goals are met or not seem to often be on their minds. There's a line in 10 Year Nap where one of the characters is described as having the longest failure to success curve in the history of children's entertainment, I believe is the line. And then one of the other books, I was trying to remember which, there's a play that's put on and it's a disaster, and someone asks another character, was it a disaster or can we consider it a kind of postmodern success? So I wondered for you and I guess all the writers that you know and you teach as well, how you grapple with this or tell people to grapple with success coming from the outside in, on the one hand, and then success coming from the inside out, on the other hand, when, as you say, you get past your 80 pages and you're writing the book you want. Has that been a struggle? Is it something that you give to your characters because it's bedeviled you or because you see it out in the world? And what's your take generally on that?
You know, it's such a, like, even you asking the question, it's like making me itchy because...
yeah.
You have to be in, that's right, you've done your job. You have to be in this weird state when you're writing a book in which you are doing the best work possible, yet you're unaware of the fact that it's going to go out in the world and people will have an opinion about it and it will affect your livelihood and everything. You have to act like it's, you know, scrimshaw. You're doing it for yourself. You're writing for yourself in some way that people carrying quilted journals might proudly say. But you're not writing for yourself. The stakes get higher and higher. When I first came to New York and was publishing my first novel, my friends and I, you know, people were in the arts, and there is that overlap in the book a little bit about that. But my first editor said, writing isn't a horse race. But of course, like, once she said that, it of course was, you know, like, don't think of an elephant, you know. But it's true, everybody's trajectory is completely different. Everyone's, and people's lives, people's writing lives have strange twists and turns. And what I love to see is a writer who's been working for years sort of have something suddenly that people want to read, because it's like, then you feel smug, like, yeah, I knew about that writer for a long time. Yeah, I mean, failure and success are really interesting things to write about, because I think they're not, of course, just about, it's not just about the world of the arts. Everybody's always taking their own pulse, you know? I mean, and we're ashamed of it, and shame is a great thing. If you can write about shame, you've really hit on, I think it's one of the deepest things, because we're all trying to sort of present ourselves in a certain way that makes us look kind of charming but modest, but maybe not too modest, you know? And the way Jules is at the beginning of the book, being very self-conscious. Yet self-consciousness, you want to show that in a character, but self-consciousness in a writer doesn't work. It's a very hard, it's like a weird yoga position that you have to get into to write a book.
And to engage in the world, and as you say, sort of disengage too. I'll call back to an earlier author in the series. Novella Bulawayo did the second, or you can tell me the date or whatever, it doesn't matter, it's in the past. But she said, somebody asked her about, the question was something about carrying water for the African diaspora, what it means to represent certain kinds of female writers. And she said something similar. She said, when you do the book, you have to believe you're really the only one, that you're at the center of this world. Of course, those things make their way in, and they become part of characters and character struggles. But you can't really ever, in the course of composing it, open up to that world, because then everything dissolves. It's like a sand character that just falls apart, you know?
Yeah, I'm just picturing, like, it would be a pinprick in that world. You can't do it. Like, no, I didn't think about women's issues or any of that when I'm writing. You can't. It's like the world is enclosed. I feel like with a novel, the world is like, it's like the end of the Truman Show when he comes upon the glass. You know, we're in, the novel is a contained thing and nothing else exists. And if you have kids when you're writing a novel, somebody else has to feed them. Although I've heard they actually need far less nutrition than people think. You just want to work all the time. You want to work all the time because you want to get it right. You want to create that world. You know that phrase world building that people use in fantasy, right? You know, writing? World building is something that all fiction writers have to engage in.
I have one more question, then a lightning round, if you'll consent to the lightning round, and then audience questions. The last question is about the children's book or the YA book that you wrote. You wrote a book about competitive Scrabble. So how did that happen? What, I mean, let me rephrase that. You're obsessed with Scrabble, right?
I've actually never played. No, it's not true. Well, I'll embarrass my son, Charlie, but he used to play competitive Scrabble and would bring home these giant trophies. And I saw, you know, what I love about writing fiction is that you're writing about little sort of subcultures. You know, there's all kinds of subcultures, the arty teenagers thinking they're the only people to feel things so deeply for the first time. Scrabble playing kids coming together and meeting and playing Scrabble. They've never seen each other before, having this wonderful day of Scrabble, just devoting themselves to it. Anything that people have a wonderful excitement for struck me as a beautiful thing to write about. Plus, the words are so incredible, and I love words, obviously. And the end of the book dealt with a big drama around the fact that the words parental, prenatal, and paternal are all anagrams. You know, that's just like, you're able to sort of take things that interest you and that you fetishize and put them into a book. So this character loves playing Scrabble, this boy, and he comes to love Scrabble because he's found to have a magical ability to read things on flat surfaces without looking, so he's drafted into the school Scrabble tournament, which is what happened to my son. No, he did not have a magical ability. And I have a YA book coming out in the fall called Bell Jar, which is sort of a mashup of everything that interested me as a young teenager, boarding school, mental illness, Sylvia Plath. But no, I mean, I think writing those books is really, anything you write comes from your sensibility. It's not coming in channeled from some other place. It comes from your sensibility, so it's still you.
All right, here's the lightning round. Now, the rules for the lightning round are, if it's a question you don't like, you can grimace or you can say pass, and I'll go to the next one. And otherwise, you should give shortish answers to them, but it's up to you really what length.
God.
All right, ready?
I thought they got rid of this on the SAT recently.
They did. They went to more essays.
Okay.
But right. They gave it to us.
That's right. Okay.
All right. If you weren't a writer, what do you think you would be?
A psychoanalyst.
What's a classic work that you've never read and won't?
Oh, God. Now I'm trying to think, what doesn't make me look that bad, but sort of good? Like, if I say one that, like, nobody here has read, you know, like, if I say, like, Silas Marner, yeah, that one.
So, what's a classic you've never read and will read or plan to?
Well, all right, I'm going to say I haven't read in its entirety Moby Dick, but I'm going to read it tonight.
All right.
I promise you.
So everybody, they can Twitter, what's it called? Twitter tomorrow morning and ask her questions about Moby Dick. You'll be done around 2 a.m., you think?
Yeah, I'm really fast.
2:15.
And I know. I heard you don't even have to read the beginning. It's like, yeah, call me Ishmael, blah, 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 you know, yeah.
Right. Then there's a whirlpool and a boat. Don't worry about it. All right. Is there a word that you would expel from the English language? One word that you just get rid of because you don't like it. You think it's had its time.
Impact is a verb.
Impact is a verb, okay.
Yeah.
What was your alternate, did you have an alternate title for The Interestings?
No, never. And I actually also have a theory that books that are going well have a title from the start because you know what it's about. I always wanted to call it that, although the problem with calling a book The Interestings, if you ever look on your Amazon page, as one is wont to do, you know, the funny people write, not very. Of course, these are the same people who write, this book arrived late, one star. You know, you just can't really win as a writer.
Do you think when they bought it, they pictured you running to the door with you bringing it to them?
Yes, they do.
Here you go, sir. Here's your
And book. I also have an extra service that I provide for readers, which is that I will hover over you and say, did you like that sentence? Did you like that one? I worked very hard on that one.
Ray Romano had the same problem, he said, with Everybody Loves Raymond when he made that sitcom that he was sure people told him, your every single review is going to be, not everybody loves Raymond. So that's the same problem.
I knew that right away, and I just sort of thought, no, but it's just, people never get tired of that one, you know.
It's a communal joke that they like to tell.
More like the uninterestings. I mean, they really write that, yeah.
If this book got made into a movie, who would you cast? Just for one role, you don't have to say
that. I never really thought about that, but people have views about that on Twitter. But they're like young actors. So I don't even know who they are.
Oh, so they're
Jared.
You would cast
Jake.
Jared?
They're Jake. I don't know. Jake. All the Jakes can be in it. And Chloe. Chloe, I believe.
When the National Book Foundation tweets this, Jared is going to be
so
Sasha, excited.
A girl and a boy named Sasha. They're all in it.
Both.
I don't know. Yes.
Which of your books was the hardest to write?
The Uncoupling, I struggled with that one. And I didn't have the title for it for a long time. So there I knew I would struggle with it because I was writing a book about what happens to female desire over time. See, you're seeing
the
trend. You're right to call me on that too. Over time is going to be, you know, well, there's not going to be a biography of me, but if anybody wrote like one of those short pamphlets and tried to hand distribute it, it would be called Over Time, right? It was hard because I had this idea of writing about female desire over time and what happens to it, and if you take an idea like that and you don't want it to sound like an article in a women's magazine, so I gave it a little fantastical element again. These women feel that they can't have sex because their fingertips. No, it's not about that. I struggled with it conceptually. And actually, then I wrote The Interesting, so I feel like certain books, I was really glad I wrote that book, because certain books are problem books, like problem plays, and they're difficult for you, and they make you work harder, and maybe the outcome isn't as big and bold and brightly covered and striped as your next book, but, you know, is it a sorbet between courses? Maybe, but you needed it. It contained vital nutrients.
My final lightning round question is actually about The Uncoupling. Did you get an Amazon bounce when Gwyneth Paltrow and Chris Martin announced they were consciously uncoupling?
You know, it's really weird. I was on the road, as I have been a lot. I was on a book tour, and I was in Nashville at Ann Patchett's wonderful Parnassus bookstore. And, like, two people came up to me and said, your publisher must be happy today. And I thought, did I win a MacArthur? What? What
close.
Happened to
it's
me
close.
Today? I was like, no, Gwyneth Paltrow's getting divorced. Yeah, that makes my publisher. And I didn't understand it. It was like they were talking another language. It was the weirdest thing, and I figured it out. But yes, a lot of people said it to me, but I don't know if there was a bounce. I'll have to look into the metrics.
Somebody research that. Yeah, research that and let us. When you finish Moby Dick, we'll
Somebody's already done researching it probably now, right? Yeah.
So now we'll go to audience questions, and usually we start at that end because that's the way I'm facing, and then work down here. They're walking around with microphones, is that true?
Wow.
Oh yeah, there's the microphone. So raise your hand and the microphone will come to you. All right.
Good evening. I have a question about censoring oneself as a writer to achieve that sort of balance between being egotistical and self-conscious. I am from the Caribbean originally, and your mother, you want to write something that your mother would read. So how do you let go of that?
My mother will read anything.
Pick a mother who will read anything. That's how you do it.
Pick a mother, right. It's a great question, because self-censorship is this insidious thing. It really is. If you write to be seen a certain way, you're not writing the book you want. I think you have to struggle with that. I think that every person struggles with that individually. As I said, writing fiction is a great thing. I think people who write memoirs struggle with it in a more open way, and they're on their own, because families get mad at you. Nobody gets mad at me, but you know, the reason they don't get mad at me is because I don't write about people I know. I don't write autobiographically. I did go to a summer camp, and I did meet my closest friend at the summer camp, and And it really was a kind of moment that I thought about a lot over time. But none of the characters in the book are based on anyone as people. So I feel like you're pretty safe. But maybe you should start giving your mother, you know, some interesting things to read that are make her, like, loosen her up a little bit first.
All right, this woman right here.
Yeah.
Thank you so much. My question is how you determine when you begin writing which characters you're going to flesh out and which ones kind of diminish as you go along. And I specifically refer to the character of Julie Jacobson's mother, whose pain I kind of felt throughout the book, and it actually diminished my desire to really want to like Jules Jacobson, but the way her mother was treated kind of diminished it. I wondered, when you start writing, do all of your characters start on a level playing field and then some develop and some kind of fall by the wayside, or do you know before you begin writing who is going to really be the dominant character and who will not?
When I started writing The Interestings, I knew, you know, it was sort of Jules's story, but it was about her and Ethan and Ash, and then Dennis came along later. For those of you who haven't read the book, just talk amongst yourselves. But you know, I struggled with something interesting, the character of Jonah. And have some of you read the book, or is this just pointless? Okay, the character of Jonah was a lesser character, and my editor, Sarah, and I had various lunches where we talked about the characters have to almost fight for their place in a book. Like, what is their place at the table? Why do they belong there? And it wasn't until I figured some things out about him and his role and the sort of creativity that he felt he'd given up, that thematically, the idea of what happens to talent over time, which was an important theme for me in the book, that I felt that I could leave him there. But he wasn't going to die. He didn't need equal time. You know, parents say they love their kids the same, but, you know, and they my kids are here. They do love their kids the same. That is my point. But on a page, you start to see, you know, well, this actually makes me think of an important point, which is that that's what revision is for. Revision is to show you the way it should be balanced or imbalanced, really. Because after a while, character doesn't need all that time. It's repetitive, or it's not furthering what you really want to say, and then you can go back and cut. And that's hard to do, especially if you've written things that are lyrical. It's always hard to cut a good line. But sometimes characters lose a lot of time on the page when you realize that they don't need more. But revision does it. Yeah.
We'll go back to that end of the room. Or to the middle. We can go to the... Wait, was there a question right in the middle? Yes. The middle gets left out.
Yeah, so this is a question about anti-heroes. So I feel that Jules Jacobson is a perfect anti-hero, really self-centered and pathetic, and you sort of hate her more as the book goes along. And you seem so upbeat and fun. You say that your characters are all kind of like blurry, but don't you draw from something that you observe? Like, do you observe people unconsciously and like, is it a thrill to write a book about an anti-hero and like make people still read to the end?
She's based on me, so I'm really hurt right now. I'm just so ashamed. When I said blurry, I really actually meant kind of physically. They're clear in some important ways. But I think with characters and this whole debate about likable characters and all of that, I mean, you have to really be willing to just show people, to just sort of not even make a point, but just sort of show what someone is like. What is someone's life like? And when we're not, you know, when we feel people are watching us, we behave a certain way. Characters, the weird thing is the writer is watching them, but supposedly no one else is. So those moments, that's why writing about sex, actually, I think can really be very useful in a book, because it's people sometimes awkward. It's people who don't want the world to see them. And Jules has all kinds of flaws, and if I took them out, she wouldn't be who she is. So you have to kind of make your peace with allowing that to happen, assuming that the reader doesn't put the book down. I mean, that's the fine balance. So it sounds to me like maybe you almost put it down a few times.
But you didn't put the book down, right?
I did not.
Right. No harm, no foul.
Good answer. Good answer.
So we'll do this end, one more from the middle.
Hi, just for the record, I didn't hate Jules Dickinson at all. I actually identified with her a lot, so I'm not sure what that says about me. But I wanted to ask you about the issue, which I think you deal with really well in all the novels of yours that I've read, of middle age, this middle age disappointment and people feeling that they haven't fulfilled their dreams. And the fact that you haven't had that trajectory yourself. You're prolific, you're successful, you get great reviews. So is it difficult to get into that mindset? And what do you base that on?
There's this oil painting in my attic of this really, this person, this wretch. you know, I just think, well, everybody's life is different. And even if you look at, say, oh, somebody's life looks really good. I mean, it's complicated. In the Up films, I think it was in 28 Up, there was a character named Susan or Susie, if you've seen the films, and she was very posh. And like when she was a child, she would say, I don't care for that, and you disliked her. And then at some point, I think in 28 Up, her father died, and her world changed, and she became more likable in some way. So I think that nobody's life is a straight road. It just isn't. So even in looking at people who are successful, people have sorrows, people have difficulties with things. So I feel that if you can take the generous view of people's lives, and it's not just about superficial success, you can write in a complex way about how people live. You know, when I look back on the people I went to summer camp with, as I, you know, did a little bit, there was a girl who, you know, my friend Martha and I were positive would become, you know, a big actress. She was in all the plays. I mean, this was the kind of camp, this was not the kind of camp where we did lanyards or sang Make New Friends, Keep the Old. I mean, we basically did Marat Saad, blood-covered scenes, and I, you know. There was a girl who was so wonderful, so we were positive she'd be famous. You know, that's the way children and teenagers think. If somebody's good at something, oh, they'll be famous. And for a long time, I didn't know what happened to her, and then when I got to sort of find out because of the internet, she'd become a physician. And I was really interested in that. It's like, was she disappointed that her life, that she hadn't become successful as an actor? But here she is having this life. And I tried to think, what do they have in common? And maybe the fact that what a good actor is able to empathize with the character she plays. And that's what we want in our doctors, empathy. So did she make her peace with her not succeeding in that other world? Maybe so. So I think it's just curvy. It's curvier than we think.
I have a question. First, I loved some of your metaphors. Your metaphor.
What about the other ones?
Yeah. Well, I loved all of them. When you talked to, when Gil was talking to, I forget which character, and they're talking about the cholesterol level, and he says, that's just like when somebody wants to describe their dream from last night and your eyes glaze over.
That was good.
So good. And there were a number like that. But here's what I want to know. Did Goodman rape Kathy? And what do most people think?
Spoiler alert.
And what did you want? Oh, sorry.
That's okay.
And what did you want? What do most people think that talk to you about it?
Well, you know, people write to me. You know, a couple of years ago, I went on Facebook. My publisher wanted me to, but I didn't even realize what I was opening myself up to. Somebody really wrote me on Facebook and said, "Did Goodman rape Kathy? You can tell me." Somebody else.
Was it you?
Was it you? Yeah. Somebody else wrote me a helpful note on Facebook that said, just parenthetical, my book club loved your book, but we all felt that the first 30% was very slow. And I thought, wow, they're reading it on Kindles, the first 30%. Right. And I think she wanted me to maybe go back and change it now.
And email
and I did, and it's much faster now. Here's what I think about what you write in a book. Again, this too was something that I thought about a lot, and I won't answer that question directly, but I'll tell it slant, as Emily Dickinson, my fellow bonnet-wearing, lace-collar-wearing writer, would say. I worked on that scene, if you remember the scene in the coffee shop when Jules and Kathy meet and talk, and the first pass, again, revision is everything. If you're writing a novel, don't worry if it's not good yet. You can really, you know, just work and work on it. The first scene had no qualities to it. It didn't have a valence to it. And I didn't know really what I thought about it. I knew something had happened between them. But then I started having her biting her nails a lot, and it gave it, it took the place of the answer. You don't need that answer. I wasn't there in that scene because those characters don't get a point of view. And that's another way that actually characters in a book, it's not a level playing field, because if you give one character not only less time on the page, but if you don't give someone a point of view, anyone who gets a point of view becomes more human to us. So what happened there was something not good, and I guess I like to think of it that way. But you can make a conclusion based on the bitten nails, I think.
One more from the middle, which I'll define as from here to here, and then that'll be the last audience question. So these...
We've got one right over here.
Oh, you have one. Oh, you have one on the end? Sorry, middle. All right, we're going.
Thank you. As an octogenarian, I'd love to see what happens to the characters who are still remaining in the interestings. And I'm wondering if it's difficult to write about people of an age that you have not personally experienced.
Oh, you mean if I were to do the sequel? The AARP field trip. Well, you know, here's a funny little side note. The summer camp that I went to, which is long gone, and it was in Stockbridge, Massachusetts, has been turned into a series of condominiums. And a lot of people went to the summer camp, distinguished people in the arts, and one of them wrote me and said, we should all move there in our dotage. And I just sort of imagined all these people I went to camp with living in this place, and like the attendants will be saying to them, I was in Zoo Story, and they'll be like, yeah, yeah, you know, here, right here. We tend to write, I have written about characters much older than myself, but it's true that I haven't written about elderly people. And I'm sure that's going to happen really soon. But when I was young, even when I was little, and starting to write, I had a wonderful teacher in first grade named Mrs. Kirby who would invite me up to her desk to dictate stories to her because she could write them down a lot faster than I could. And basically, I was sort of like a businessman and she was like my secretary. Take a letter, Mrs. Kirby, you know. And one of the things that I often wrote about was older people. I had a story that my mother saved about two truckers. I mean, think of me, think of trucker fiction. But the dialogue was, get up on the rig, Mac, because I think I wanted to approximate the world. And one way a child who has no power in the world tries to do that is through the world of adults. And I think that sometimes we don't want to look as closely at the elderly, and that may be why I haven't done it yet. But it's coming fast at me with its headlights. So you will see it soon. Thank you.
And you've never used that, get up on the rig, Mac, in another book?
Well, it's the name of my next book. I didn't want to give that...
The rig.
The rig. Yes. Why change... If it works, why change it, right?
Well, if it's working... All right, well, thank you. And I want to thank the audience for coming tonight. You picked a good one.